Hello and welcome. Here we are with the last 18-inch contender of 2023. This is the Acer Predator Helios 18 for 2023 featuring the RTX 4080 and a stunning mini LED display at 250Hz. Let's jump right in. The Helios 18 is equipped with a pretty standard i9-13900HX 24-core 32-thread CPU that is pretty common with all of the high-end gaming laptops this year. It's equipped with 32 gigs of DDR5 running at 5600 MHz in dual-channel config, and most notably, it has the 18-inch QHD Plus 250Hz 16:10 aspect ratio True HDR 100% DCI-P3 color coverage 1000 nits 5 millisecond mini LED display. It also is equipped with an NVIDIA RTX 4080 12GB GPU with a max TGP of 165 watts. And also notable is the per-key RGB mini LED backlit keyboard, which makes the backlight quite stunning on this particular laptop. All of this comes in at not a light load, however. We're sitting at around 3.4 kilograms or right around 7.5 pounds and a price of around $4,000 Canadian. And a quick overview of the actual body and the build quality of this device itself. So the top lid is aluminum here. You can see it does catch a few fingerprints, but otherwise not too bad. We have this nice gamery grill design bat here. It does come with some face plates on the back that you can swap out if you would like to customize the device a little bit more. If we open up the lid here and look under the lid, and you know, on the keyboard deck here, we've got a very nice, you know, QWERTY style keyboard with some, you know, abbreviated keys on this. Now, because it is an 18-inch laptop, you've got a bigger deck. I wish they had stretched this out all the way to fill the deck, you know, properly and put a proper TKL keyboard on here. That would have been absolutely fantastic. Fulfill the gamers' needs as well as the needs of any programmers and just everyday typists. On the rear of the device, we have a barrel power plug, HDMI 2.1 port connected directly to the NVIDIA RTX 4080 for driving external monitors at up to 4K 120Hz. And finally, we have two Thunderbolt 4 ports on the rear of the device. We also have some exhausting here to both sides, and these little covers are extendable or removable, so it comes with another pair of different color. I believe they're red in the box, so if you wish to change them out for a little bit of aesthetic and customization, you can pop those off. They're magnetically attached and you can swap them out for a different color look and feel. On the left-hand side of the device, we're graced with a pull-down RJ45 gigabit Ethernet port. This is not 2.5 gigabit only. We have a USB Type 3.2 Gen 2 port. This is Type A. We have a micro SD card slot and a combo headphone microphone jack. On the right, you're graced with some LED indicators. You've got one here for battery and power and charging, and another one for activity, whether the device is powered on or not. You have two USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type A ports, one which is always on for charging. You can adjust that behavior in the BIOS. And finally, at the rear, you have a Kensington lock port. At the front of the device, you get a flush surface, so you really have to kind of dig in there with a fingernail to get this device open, or to grab with two hands from both sides of the lid to pull the device up. It is not a one-hand opener. And finally, on the rear of the device, we have two cooling fans. We can see it through this plastic venting on the bottom grill, and we see a lot of heat pipe work here. Unfortunately, there is no vapor chamber on the Predator Helios 18 for 2023. I think that is a big miss. Got some nice rubberized feet here to keep this elevated above the table, as this is the air intake, and the air is then exhausted out the sides and out of the back. So you've got four exhaust ports. Sadly, these two fans spin at very high RPM speeds, and this device can get very loud in the turbo and performance modes. Powering on this device, you press this power button here to turn the device on. It does come out of the box with a Bing, a Predator sound that you can turn off either through Predator Sense software or through the BIOS. If you're in an office environment, you may want to do that very easily. At the top left of the device here, we have a mode switching button. If you're on battery, you'll only get two options. Green is eco mode, and if you press it, you'll get blue, which is a balance mode. When you're connected to AC power, the mode toggle button here gives you a few extra options. Right now, I'm in purple mode. If I press this, let's get all the way back down to white, which is our quiet mode. So this means we're in silent gaming performance, and you're gonna have, or silent mode, very little gaming performance. Press it one more time, you get a flash of blue on the keyboard RGB. Now we're in balance mode. Thermals will be a little bit higher in this particular mode. One more press, we're now in purple. So this is the performance mode. And then one final press will get us into the turbo modes, where the fans finally start to ramp up. And that's the most easier way to recognize what's happening and what mode you're currently in. In addition, if you go into Predator Sense, you can see what mode you have selected by toggling this button. And as you cycle through, you'll see quiet, balanced, performance, performance, and finally turbo. On occasion, it does get stuck and the mode cycling does not work, or it either pressing this button doesn't actually cycle you through the modes, or if you try to switch from, particularly in Predator Sense, it does not work. I've seen that happen most of the time if you're already in-game, which means you'll need to quit your game, exit it, and then try to do that. If in that case it still does not work, a quick reboot seems to resolve that issue. And finally, we'll demonstrate the keyboard by doing a 1 minute typing test here so you can listen to the sound and the tactility of the keyboard. It's actually a pretty nice keyboard overall. I don't have many complaints with it. The keys are nicely sized, well spaced. You don't have any issues with accidental misses. There's no macro keys here that are odd. This tilde key is a little bit abbreviated. I wish it was a full size key as you have on a standard keyboard, but alas, that's not a very often used key. And you have your numpad here, which is abbreviated. I'm not a big fan of this on the keyboard, but it gets the job done. So let's jump in and let's listen to the typing sounds. All right, and there we have it, a quick typing test. I've got pretty much 98 words per minute on this laptop. It's actually quite comfortable to type because you have an 18-inch keyboard deck. You know, the keyboard is pushed back a little bit way, so as long as your ergonomic height adjusted and your chair is in the right position, it's actually quite comfortable. You don't get a lot of biting in like you have here into the arms. Yeah, with the other keyboards, this is a little bit sharp. I wish it was a little bit more rounded so you didn't have this kind of effect on your arm. And speaking of trackpad, we've got here a Precision, Windows Precision trackpad with a Corning Gorilla Glass surface. Doing gestures and mousing around on this is actually pretty fantastic. The size is great too. If you have average or big hands, you're not going to have a problem with being able to navigate on this particular trackpad. And overall, the sound is pretty decent too. Activating the gestures in Windows are fantastic. The touchpad is great. The overall feel is very good. The touchpad surface is very nice and smooth. It's also easy to clean and it doesn't pick up fingerprints quite as well as some of the surrounding surfaces and materials on this laptop. As for audio, the Helios 18 features two downward firing speakers focused on the front and to the left and the right side. They're nothing to write home about. They are very tinny at, you know, much louder than 80%. Even 75% starts to get tinny. They do get decently loud though and can drown out the fan noise if you crank them all the way up. And as long as you have auto mode engage and not max fans and running in balance mode perhaps to, you know, reduce the noise a little bit further. Now within Predator Sense, there is a True Harmony control which allows you to slightly tune the speakers for a particular type of sound. And this works for the headset as well as the speakers on the internal device. In fact, they're just so mediocre that Acer didn't even bother mentioning them in the tech specs on their own website or on the product marketing page. So take it or leave it, but you'll need a good pair of headphones to really enjoy the audio experience with this laptop. Communications in this Helios 18 is provided by a killer Wi-Fi 6E AX1675i. That's a Wi-Fi 6E 802.11ax wireless card. It functions pretty much just like every other wireless card that I've tested that is of the Wi-Fi 6E variety. This is also a common component that's used by Alienware and their Dell laptops. So it works pretty well. It gets, you know, decently high speeds and can sustain transfers fairly well. I didn't have any interference issues. There was no issues with connectivity or maintaining a wireless connection. And also gaming over wireless, lag was pretty low. I didn't have any issues in my local network. It also is equipped with a gigabit Ethernet controller to the left side of the device. There's a flip down Ethernet jack that you can plug into for wired experiences. And again, that was also fairly efficient, you know, pretty standard Ethernet speeds. I didn't have any issues with connectivity there as well. And Bluetooth is provided thanks to Bluetooth version 5.3. The way to tell that is to look at this particular number here, the LMP. So in this case, LMP is 12. This is the link protocol, and 12 version corresponds to Bluetooth version 5.3. So it does have the latest standard of Bluetooth. It also has a Bluetooth low energy enumerator, which means you can connect the latest pair of headphones and TWS headsets and earbuds, which will give you the lowest latency and also low energy consumption when you're connected with a Bluetooth device. This is a test of the webcam on the Predator Helios 18 for 2023. This is one of the last behemoth 18-inch laptops that's new in the market this year. 18 inches, it's giving us fantastic amount of real estate for gaming and all of our professional work and fun and study and all that. And this also comes with a 1080p full HD webcam. Thankfully, all across the board, most of these laptops have upgraded to full HD 1080p webcams, although only at 30 frames per second. Would love to see that get bumped up to at least 60 in the next generation to come. But that said, how is the audio? This does have Array microphones as well, and it has a pretty decent looking picture, I believe. The sharpening and some of the software effects seems to be making it look pretty decent. Let me know what you think in the comments below about the picture quality from the built-in webcam from this display. Is it sufficient perhaps for streaming and doing your gaming online, some meetings and catching up on schoolwork, and also how the audio sounds from the built-in microphone array that's in this laptop.
Now let's take some thermal readings on the keyboard surface and around the keyboard deck, the trackpad, the WAS keys, and the arrow keys to see what type of surface temperatures you'll be looking at while you're gaming and using this laptop. It's running in turbo mode here with max fans engaged, sitting in the Furmark benchmark, 175 degrees or 175 watts being pushed to that GPU, and it's sitting at 86 degrees, basically at the thermal throttle limit. The CPU is at 80 degrees and about 35 watts. So let's have a look here at some of the surface temperatures. You can see here that at the top here, it's nice and cool, 30 degrees, no real hot spots. It's nice and cool. And if we look at the top function rows, the max is still at around 30 degrees. Same thing goes for the next row down. Perhaps a little bit cooler again, right around 30 degrees as we head across the keyboard deck. And then as we head to the WAS key, so here we are at W, about 30 degrees, A, S, and D. They're all around 30 degrees, no particular issues, no hot spots there. And it is really nice and cool to the touch. It's not even warm. So that is actually a fantastic showing for this particular laptop. And if I were to put my gun aside and just put my hands here, I could keep my hand here endlessly and there is no issue with actual heat being transferred to your hand. So you can play a long shot away from the laptops of 2 or 3 years ago where this device was so hot that they would start to singe your fingertips. So a fantastic showing all across the board for 2023 for some of these high-end gaming laptops. You can play hours on end without getting thermally singed to your fingertips here. And same goes for the trackpad. If you look at the trackpad here, this is generally where the battery is located. No hot spots, well below 30 degrees in terms of temperatures, and nice and cool, and a very good showing in terms of surface temperatures here. Now, because something that Acer did, which is actually smart, is keeping all the heat back here. So if you look at some of these temperatures here, you should see somewhere there's hot spots of around 50 degrees. But because you'll never actually be touching any of these surfaces in your in your gaming experience, I saw 48 there. So it does, there are certain areas where the GPU and the heat pipes exhaust, they meet the copper fins, and that's where you'll see some of the hot spots on this. But you'll never need to touch any of this area, and as long as you're not keeping this on your lap to do some gaming, you'll have a pleasant experience with this laptop overall. And a quick overview here of the Predator Sense software. This looks very much similar to what I tested with the Helios 16 from earlier in this year. We've still got this home dashboard that you land on when you first power up the laptop and you open up Predator Sense. This is the software that's used to control the aspects of the laptop. And as you press the mode toggle button on the laptop, or you select here to toggle through the different modes, it will cycle the lights on the RGB keyboard, cycle you through what's happening on the particular modes. As you can see, pressing this button is toggling the different modes here. And if we go to the home setting, it will be reflected here. System mode is balanced. You'll get some quick stats. And in the scenario here, other than this, there is really not much else you can control other than the fans. You can set it to max fans mode if you really want to crank them, or leave it to auto. I find that auto fans on this particular laptop actually works quite well, but they do ramp up to quite over 6,000 RPM and they can get very, very loud. So make use of that auto fans unless you absolutely have a reason to toggle that max fans mode. You've got some lighting controls over the lighting on the RGB laptop. It's an individually lit per key RGB backlit keyboard. It's actually a very nice and bright light. It's, you know, it shines through the keycaps very, very well. It's a pleasant experience, and you can take this and control all of those aspects, as well as the LEDs on the back of the device here. And finally, in advanced settings, you can go in and tune some of the aspects of the sound system itself within this laptop. Do the overdrive on the display to pull it from 5 down to 3 milliseconds for the response time. And you can also click here to toggle through the different profiles for the effects on your keyboard and set up these scenario profiles. You can also go into monitoring here, take a quick peek at some of the stats here. Of course, keep in mind that from this software, you have no control over undervolting and certainly no control over overclocking on any of the aspects of this laptop, CPU nor the GPU. And considering that this is a flagship device for 2023 from Acer Predator, I think this is a huge miss. You know, I don't know what you were thinking, Acer, but please, with the next iteration, fix this, or with just the software update, and give us the ability to undervolt our CPUs here and also to overclock that GPU. That 4080 can do wonders with a little bit of tweaking. So we'd love to see those capabilities within the Acer Predator Sense software. I've also booted into the BIOS, and there's nothing there that allows me to turn on or enable CPU overclocking, undervolting, or GPU overclocking, anything to that effect, which is absolutely essential for a Predator, and I think a performance, a high-end performance and enthusiast gaming laptop that is the class of this device. And let's take some noise profile readings from this laptop running in the four different modes here, starting with the white color here. This is the quiet or silent mode. Our GPU is running at around 55 watts on that 4080 12 gigabytes, 71 degrees on the GPU and about 77 degrees on the CPU. Our noise level is about 48 decibels. Now we'll switch into balance mode. Our 4080 ramps up to about 100 watts and still stays at around 77 degrees Celsius. The CPU is now at 80 degrees and our reading is about 52 decibels. Now we'll jump into performance mode. The GPU has now kicked up to about 140 watts, sitting at 82 degrees. The CPU is at 81 degrees still, and our audio or noise reading is about 63 decibels. And finally, in turbo mode, we're hitting at about 165 to 170 watts actually on the GPU, a little bit beyond what the advertised max TDP is on this particular GPU in this laptop. 4080 is now sitting at 86 degrees and it seems to be jumping up and jumping down. It is being thermal throttled and it goes back up to 165 plus watts, then gets thermal throttled again and jumps back up. The CPU is now sitting at 94 degrees Celsius and our audible noise level reading is about 72 decibels. So finally, in max fans mode, it's not that much of a difference, but our GPU is still sitting at about 170, 172 watts. It's gone up a little bit beyond the advertised 165 watts max TDP, but our GPU is now sitting at 86 degrees. It's basically thermal throttling at this point. This is the full thermal capability of this laptop and the cooling system, I believe. So it drops back down, jumps back up, drops back down. It does hit 175, 177, even 178 watts in certain cases, but then quickly drops back down, and you see a toggle between the temperatures on the GPU before it jumps right back up there again. So 86, 85, 84, 86, 85, 84 degrees seems to be the dance that this laptop is doing with that GPU. The CPU is locked at around 85 degrees, you know, quite toasty, but nothing near the 100 degree thermals that you'd have to be concerned about. Keep in mind that at this max fans mode, the noise level isn't all that different than just turbo mode with auto fans. We're still sitting at about 72 degrees. It's not a good showing, it's quite loud, and at this point you definitely need a good pair of headphones to drown out that noise, particularly with active noise cancellation would be very useful, but we're sitting right at 86 degrees and that GPU continues to push 175 watts without issue.
And to say just a few words about battery life on this Predator Helios 18, it's equipped with a 90 watt hour lithium ion battery and it comes with a 330 watt power brick to charge. It also has USB power delivery, so you could use that in a pinch to charge this device. However, that's not officially stated within the manual, nor is it stated within the specifications on Acer's website. I've read this on, you know, a few different review sites and others don't mention it, so that's a mixed bag there. I don't have a 140 watt adapter here or 100 watt adapter with USB to try testing at the moment, but it says that that is potentially possible. However, you will not be able to game on that. It will be just for light office work. That said, the battery will give you around 3 hours of mixed use. You know, this is not a battery life champ by any means, and I think it's one of the underperformers of the year in terms of the other competition, the other 18 inch laptops, but not by much, maybe just a few minutes or perhaps 30 minutes max versus the G18, the Alienware M18, and the Razer Blade 18. So that said, you can put it into quiet mode, get some office work done, and if you deal with the brightness, you turn the brightness all the way down, perhaps to 30%, you may be able to extend that a little bit more, but you should be looking at around the 3 hours mark. So if you're getting this for battery life, you should be looking at a different laptop. In order to get HDR gaming running on this Helios 18, there's a few steps that you need to do. So start with display settings and make sure you toggle use HDR to on. Once you've done that, click on it for additional settings. Scroll down, make sure that you leave auto HDR off as it can cause some adverse effects. Make sure use HDR is toggled to on as well. And you should see video streaming and HDR supported as supported. Then the next step, there is one more thing you need to do in order to get the color calibrated correctly. Go to that link, click on Windows HDR Calibration, download this from the Microsoft Store. It's a free app, and this will guide you through a setup in order to set up your highs and lows in terms of the capabilities of your particular device. And once you do that, you'll go through a guided setup and end up with a color profile in your Windows display settings. In order to do that, make sure that you turn down the brightness on your display in order to be able to see some of the patterns if they do not show, if there's not, you know, enough depth. Once you've completed the calibration with the Windows HDR calibration tool, which is a free software from the Microsoft App Store, enable HDR in Windows display settings and use HDR is toggle is enabled, as I've just shown. The experience on this laptop and this particular mini LED display is outstanding. With a little bit more calibration, perhaps with a professional calibration tool, which unfortunately I do not have, this display is simply stunning. The brightness levels of 1000 nits, it really shows off the highlights and the shadows, and the contrast is just unparalleled to any other laptop display that I've seen, short of OLED, of course. Now, considering that there are no OLED screens available at this display resolution, at this size, in a laptop yet, this is the best you can get to an outstanding gaming experience in terms of visual fidelity, the color, the contrast, the sharpness, the clarity, and just the overall pop. With games such as Hogwarts Legacy, where HDR is truly supported, and other titles, for example, Borderlands 3, even though it's an older title, as well as Fortnite, I've tested in all of these games with HDR and without HDR, and once it's calibrated, that's the key here, once it's calibrated, the colors are stunning. The visuals are absolutely fantastic. Now, there is one trick to keep note of. When you do have the display calibrated, as I mentioned, during calibration, you may need to lower the overall brightness in order to hit or to see the patterns that Windows HDR tool will ask you for calibration. Once that is done, and of course you need to do this because lack of a professional calibration tool means we've got to work with the free software that we're provided. That will require lowering the brightness perhaps down to 80%. And I found that even in HDR gaming, that around 80% is actually where the colors are popping. It's visually stunning. It's very visually rich to look at, but you don't have any of the adverse effects, for example, of overblown highlights or overexposed settings in the game. And that's basically the best way to enjoy an HDR gaming experience here. Now, make sure that with every game you pick
two tested. I mentioned three here that actually support proper HDR. Hogwarts Legacy, which is a later release. Now Fortnite, of course, as well. That's a it's basically an eye candy show for, you know, those who want to enjoy the HDR experience. And of course, Borderlands 3 as well. Even though it's an older game, don't knock it. The HDR implementation is quite good. And the colors, the highlights, simply from the LED lights, the lamps, you know, the shadows versus, you know, the darker areas. And in Fortnite, I did find it easier to spot enemies in the distance, particularly in darker areas or areas are in shadows where otherwise it would be suppressed on a traditional IPS or a VA display. So this display does require professional calibration. I do not know if Acer provides it from the factory with calibration, but after you do that using the free Windows tool, it's leaps and bounds out of away from what you'd get just out of the box experience with this mini LED display. That true HDR 1000 nits display, in my opinion, is truly worth the price of admission for this laptop, for the Acer Predator Helios 18 for 2023. And as we can see here, I can demonstrate, it's very, very difficult to show here because my capture card does not support HDR. And then on top of that, oh, let me just grab this page here. There we go. I'm not able to show it to you here because I need a capture card which supports HDR, or at least HDR pass through. Then the video that I need to render needs to be in HDR, which means my other cameras and my other equipment need to be HDR, otherwise colors would be all off. So it's very difficult to show here on YouTube. But you know, if you were to take my word for it, this is absolutely the best display I've seen on a laptop ever, shy of an OLED display. And considering that this is the first iteration probably in many, many years back to 18.4 inches used to be in the older days with the older laptops, 18 inch displays at this size, at this resolution, it's sharp, it's stunning, it's visually a very eye candy experience. I do wish that with the next iteration of the display, it comes from the factory pre-calibrated. That would be an out of the box, just turn it on and go experience. That said though, with a professional calibration tool, I believe this could really get dialed into just an absolutely stunning visual display and experience for gaming on your PC. I have no other display, you know, whether it's a monitor or another laptop that can compare to this one, aside from my OLED TV. So this is simply stunning. I simply cannot show you the experience. I think you need to believe it or see it to believe it for yourself. It needs to be something that's experienced in person. Just seeing the contrast difference, the highlights, the shadows, the visual pop, the clarity, the richness of the color, the wide gamut at play here, you have to see it in person with SDR gaming first and then the switch over to HDR to really appreciate what mini LED and this contrast is all about. HDR truly is something, and I cannot wait for it to be more prominent and just basically supported in all games. Since this is as much as a visual affair as it is an interactive affair, I believe that the visuals will take these games a long, long way. And Nanite with the Unreal Engine has a lot of that stuff baked in, and they're showing it off with Fortnite. And if you want to see a real demonstration, go there and have a look. Even though it's cartoonish and not realistic, you'll get the richness experience that you're after with mini LED. So hands down, the best experience from a display on any laptop that I've tested in years and that I've seen entirely. And in my time over the last 20 years or so using laptops. So until OLED makes its way to here, this is the best you can get. I wish I could take this display and transplant it into an Alienware M18, and I think that would be a killer gaming laptop. Now, let's talk about gaming and particularly gaming performance. So if you're looking to get this laptop and your primary purpose is gaming, then you'll have to know a few things here. Number one, the 4080 with 12 gigs of VRAM is definitely a minimum, I believe, this year and this generation if you want any level of future-proofing on your device for the next maybe 2 or perhaps 3 years. The 4080, because it can push all the way up to 175 watts, in this laptop particularly 165 watts, you will need that amount of power to get the performance that you're after, particularly with some of these more taxing, more demanding, higher textured, higher fidelity AAA games that are coming out. Cyberpunk, for example, is still the most taxing game despite all the years of optimizations and updates. And if you're looking to play Starfield here, so you can see that I'm playing this game, and let me just put up my stats. You can see here that I'm running at around 42 FPS, and if we jump in and like take a look at the settings here, we'll see that this is running at the native 1600p resolution of this display. I've got dynamic resolution on. The preset that I'm using is Ultra, and I have FSR2 enabled. If I turn FSR2 off, then you'll see here that we get
basically no difference in this particular game, so I'm not sure what is up with the implementation of FSR2 for this particular game. It is supposed to work on all GPUs, but in this particular instance it seems to be not really affecting the frame rates all that much. In fact, it looks exactly the same whether I'm using native rendering or whether I enable it. The second thing to keep note is that the sound from this laptop when you're gaming at that 175 watts is pretty atrocious. You know, the fans spin at over 6,000 RPM and it gets very, very loud, and it's very hard to enjoy an gaming experience. After 20 minutes to half an hour of that, your ears are ringing when you do turn the fans finally off or put it into a silent mode. So that said, you'll need a good pair of headphones. And also, number three, if you're looking to get a balance of everything from this laptop, then that is absolutely possible. If you don't want it to be just a dedicated gaming laptop, but you're after being able to do everything and this is going to be your only computing device, in that scenario, this is a much more appropriate fit. You can basically set this to a balance mode, or if you're interested in a little bit more power, you can put it into performance mode, just ignoring the turbo mode altogether for the little 5%, perhaps maybe 10% gain in certain games that you'll get, but you'll trade off a lot of that fan noise as a result. So if you put it into a balanced mode, which is what I have here, I'm running at about 48 FPS, and I'll just toggle it on here to show very quickly. I've covered this elsewhere in a dedicated manner, but if I switch it over to performance mode from balanced, and of course, sometimes it refuses to toggle, so you'll have to quit the game in that case and, you know, toggle the mode and come back into this laptop. So please, Acer, fix your Predator Sense software. So that's one caveat there, but in balanced mode, I'm running almost not silent. I can hear the fans, but they're very inaudible at ear level, and I can enjoy this game at a very respectable frame rate. The G-Sync and the FreeSync Premium display on this is absolutely fantastic. The mini LED is just gorgeous. I've mentioned this elsewhere, so this is definitely the display to get. Now, the other thing I want to point out here as well is when you are gaming on this particular laptop, you'll need to spend some time to tune the settings in your particular game to figure out what combinations of presets will help you get closer to that 60 FPS if you want to play in a quiet and kind of comfortable manner on this particular laptop. The plus side, the surface temperatures never get hot to the touch, maybe slightly warm after hours of gaming sessions. And that said, overall, it is a good value. The 4080 is a must. The price could be better. However, I've seen it at, you know, $500 and more steeper discounts on the Acer store. So keep an eye out for those deep discounts, and you can pick up a 4080 equipped Helios 18. And overall, it's a pretty good value as long as you understand some of the caveats that I've just explained. And that said, we'll now look at a few different benchmarks from a few different games that I've tested to show you what kind of figures we can get. All testing was done at the native 1600p resolution of this display, with turbo mode turned on with auto fans, because I found that auto fans and max fans made basically no difference. The RPMs were very, very similar, so you won't have different results there. Let's jump in and take a look at some of the benchmarks. A total of 13 games were tested using the RTX 4080 in this Predator Helios 18. All of the testing was done in turbo mode with the auto fans enabled, as setting to max fans only increased the noise slightly and only the performance very slightly as well, within margin of error. So that said, most of these games performed very, very well. Wherever possible, RT was enabled, that's ray tracing, and wherever was possible, DLSS was also engaged. In some of the tests, however, DLSS was not enabled because it was not available as a quality or balanced preset, but rather some other RT settings or other DXR shadows, etc., as in the case with Far Cry. And wherever possible, HDR was also enabled to try to get the best visual quality. Perhaps that adds a little bit more taxing, attacks on the GPU to process that other color gamut. So that was enabled wherever possible. And as we can see here, that the performance is quite good. And all of these games are playable at ultra settings, maxed out on that 4080 in turbo mode. Synthetic benchmarks were performed using the 3DMark suite of graphics tests. All of these tests were performed after Windows update with all of the latest versions applied, including the August 2023 update, the latest drivers from NVIDIA, and also any other updates that needed to be run, including the BIOS updates for this laptop to be at the latest version. That said, the mode for operation for the laptop was in turbo mode and with the max fans set to, or fan speed set to auto mode. Changing it between auto fans and max fans only slightly bumped up the test results in terms of within a margin of error, so that's why they were left as they were. And in some of these tests, if you see custom instead of a specific resolution, such as 1080p or 1440p, that is because by default, 3DMark only has standard resolutions and 2560 by 1600, being that it is a 16 by 10 aspect ratio and kind of a non-standard resolution. It is not supported out of the box by 3DMark 10. And that's why I had to specifically go in, set the resolution at that resolution, and it changed all the tests for custom rather than reporting for a standard 1080p or 1440p mode. And finally, to round it out, we'll show here that the FurMark benchmark can indeed reach that 165 watts advertised on that RTX 4080. I had this laptop running this test for quite a while before resuming this test and capturing this screenshot. We can see here that we see 164 watts with 87 degrees on the GPU. We are seeing some thermal throttling, but it does hit the intended marked max TGP that's advertised. So there you have it. Oh man, this is a beauty. This mini LED display is gorgeous. I absolutely love it. Ooh, hello. Boom. Oh, come on, no fuel. All right, time to summarize this review. So basically what can be said, the positives, the mini LED display, absolutely love it. Shy of OLED, this is the only display on a laptop that has wowed me, and I mean truly wowed me. That true HDR with a little calibration using the free Windows tool and 1000 nits of brightness with this mini LED display, oof. And the wide color gamut, 100% DCI-P3 coverage, 5 milliseconds response time, G-Sync and FreeSync support, oh, it's like icing on the cake and then some, you know, with a few cherries on top, if I might add. An absolutely gorgeous display coupled with 4080 delivers the performance for days. If you don't mind playing with DLSS and FSR2 settings to basically lock to a 60 FPS, you know, in some games as needed, you can then get by with a near silent gaming experience too by playing in balance mode. If you want all the frame rates, of course you can head into performance or turbo mode. You're gonna get those fan speeds to go along with it and also the fan noise. Bring a good pair of headphones and you'll enjoy your experience. The keyboard is very nice. It's actually quite tactile, and I enjoyed my time with it more than I expected to do so. I'm very tied now between this laptop and the M18. It's a very, very tough decision. The mini LED display on this just blows everything else out of the water. And by comparison, the M18 has the weakest display of the 18-inch laptops this year with just 165 Hz and barely 300 nits of brightness. What happened, Alienware? In any case, there are a few downsides here though. Number one, it does not have a vapor chamber, so you get thermal throttling in some games at around 86, 87 degrees, which is the thermal max for the 4080 12 gig that's in this laptop. Despite that, we're getting very good frame rates, and you know the throttling is not too much of an issue. I think if you don't mind locking to 60 or maybe even 90 frames per second in many games, apply DLSS quality settings, you'll have a good experience overall. And it is a little bit hefty, so I would love to see, you know, the sides, they're a little bit sharp, so when you rest, your arms dig in a little bit here, because you have to be, you know, put your hands far back, because it's an 18-inch display, so you have a lot more surface area to cover to reach the keyboard. That's just a small gripe there. I would love to see some sort of biometric authentication on this laptop as well. In 2023, to have that missing is, you know, just a no-brainer. And finally, the Predator Sense. Oh, what is this software, Acer? Really, we still have no ability to undervolt the CPU, overclock the CPU or the GPU. And I think on an enthusiast level laptop that costs 4,000 Canadian dollars, it is unacceptable in this day and age. By far the weakest showing of the Control Center softwares this year. You know, Gigabyte is far ahead, HP is far ahead, Lenovo is the farthest ahead of all of them. And I would say it would be a tie between Lenovo and Alienware. But now that said, with this laptop, basically completed my coverage of all 18-inch gaming laptops for this particular year. Stay tuned for a coming up video that's going to be an update. Finally, now that I've tested all four 18-inch contenders, which is the laptop you should be buying and why, and some buying decisions to guide you through there. And that's all I have to say here. So thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. Please like my content and share across your social media channels to help grow this particular channel. All of this comes out of my pocketbook, so any subs, shares are appreciated so I can help continue to bring you more content like this in the future. And thanks for watching. See you in the next one.